professor from the University of Messina, Italy, and he's visiting us for a couple of weeks. This is the second week, so he will be here for available a couple of days more, so till Friday. So. And anyway, he's working on mainly distributed system, cloud computing, service engineering, Internet of Things, and all this stuff. And he will present some activities, some ideas, some projects that are currently under development in the University of Messina. So thank you for coming, Mr. Puliafito, and now it's your... The audience is for you.
Okay, so thank you. Good morning, everybody. Today I will try to give you some short inputs related to Internet of Things, applications, Arduino technologies. But before starting with the technical part, I will try to give a very fast presentation about University of Messina, the research group I have there, the things that we are doing. So very quickly, University of Messina is one of the about 70 university in Italy. More or less we have around 25,000, 26,000 students at the moment. It is organized in different blocks. This is the engineering faculty where we are. There are at the moment 11 departments available in the university. With regard to information technology, computer science, we have two groups. This one is the research center, or better, the computing center of the university, where there are about 50 people working there, and they are mainly focused on service development. So they develop software to provide services inside the universities and also to external customers, maybe public administrations, companies. I will tell you something about that. This other group instead, that stands for Mobile Distributed System Lab, is more focused on research. So here we do research in ICT. Some of these research ideas may become products that we will pass to the other group that will deliver the service as a commercial service. Okay? So we always have these two aspects, that is the pure research and also something more related to reality, that is the transformation of some research idea in some products. Okay, these are the people that work there. Sometimes they are more, sometimes a little bit less. It depends on the projects that we are running. This is a very fast list of some European projects we have been involved in, but I will go more in details in the technical presentation. More or less they are all related to cloud computing and applications on top of cloud, but I will go more in details later on in the second part of this presentation. I already mentioned this attempt that we have to move from the exploration phase to the exploitation phase. We believe this is very important, just to avoid to have only theoretical things, but even some concrete products. I am not saying that all the research ideas will become products, but some of them maybe can be converted in something concrete. The main research area that we are touching is related with the cyber physical system, that means also cloud computing, that means Internet of Things, so we have objects on one side, the physical object on one side, we have the cyber world on the other, and we try to connect these two worlds, integrating as much as possible the objects and their representation, or virtual representation, with the computing and the storage part of the infrastructure to process the information that the sensors can detect from huge amount of objects distributed in the environment. We will arrive to the definition of this concept, software-defined city, where you will see some physical part, that is the city itself, the possibility to capture information from this environment, and then to move these informations on the cloud, the cyber part, to analyze this data, to understand what is happening, and then maybe actuate some control action through the actuators that you have on the physical part. So the problem is how to integrate these two parts that then will provide you the instruments to control a complex environment as a city, for example. And there are many kind of possible applications that can be developed. Just an example, but we will talk also about this later on. We have these Smart Me projects. It's a crowd funding initiatives that we launched about 8 to 10 months ago. We collected some money on the internet, and now we are developing the basic infrastructure inside the city of Messina to deliver new kind of services. So the basic steps to create a smart environment. We will talk about this. Okay? And always in this direction, we have also strong connection with Arduino, that is the company nowadays in charge of producing boards, sensing boards. Probably you know, you already, I don't know, use this kind of device, very small device, that are able to easily sense and detect information from the environment, and also to interact with the environment, for example piloting electrical engine, valves, and things like that. So this company created a spin-off company with our university that is located in the engineering faculty, just the floor below where I have my office. The company there is specifically focused on software development. So Arduino is distributed all over the world. It is in Switzerland, the United States, in northern part of Italy with regards the production of the physical production of the device, in Asia, in China, and so on. And in Messina they have this company that developed the software for the boards and all the environment where these boards are integrated. So there is a strong connection with this company, and with them we develop several project initiatives, research development, system creations, and so on. Possible applications where we are working now are related with smart lighting, so some kind of smart control of the lighting in a public environment, in the main square of Messina, the different lights are controlled with this kind of technology, fleet management, precision agriculture, e-health, innovative building, I will tell you something about that, and individual protection devices are just some possible examples, so quite different one from the other, but that all belongs to a smart control environment, okay? So smart city, possible services that can be developed in that kind of environment. Okay, new way of thinking. Why? Because we are trying to include this kind of concepts, technologies inside our master course that is called Engineering and Computer Science. We have a system that is 3, the bachelor, plus 2, the master. So we are talking about the plus 2. It's fully delivered in English. So just to try to attract students from other countries, we have already some foreign students there that attend the course regularly. It is somehow innovative, not only for the English speaking, that is not such a big innovation, but because it tries to put together, to merge the computer engineering on one side and computer science on the other. So inside the same course there are these two different components that usually are kept somehow separated. So the more theoretical part, the more implementative engineering part, they are inside the same course, and the students can autonomously decide if they want to go for an engineering track or computer science track. So it's on their decision. This is why it is called interclass, because it joined together these two different worlds. There are a few examples like this in Italy, two or three, no more. So there is some kind of innovations also from this point of view. These are some reference that you can access if you want to have more information, so you can send email. And of course, if there are questions, just stop me and I will try to answer to your questions, okay? So, also I also included some reference that maybe you want to give a look if you want to go more in details on this kind of things. Okay, so the second part is actually the main part of the presentation, where we will go more in details with regards the integration of the Internet of Things and the cyber world. So this is the overall subjects that we will cover in this lecture. I will try to provide some tools, some methodologies that can be applied to manage and control a urban environment, a city, and to make this city a sort of smart city. Okay, so we will talk about what a smart city is. Then I will try to focus a little bit on Arduino technology, what is new there, why is becoming so popular, and then some application to this complex environment in terms of software-defined city, so where the software is able to provide the extra layer of intelligence to manage such huge amount of data, such complex environment. So we start with this picture where this architect, very famous, he was born about 100 years ago, introduced new development concepts, new way of building a construction, building a house, where he understood for the first time that these systems were very complex and they were integrating different aspects. So for the first time he was talking about a new way of architecture, of constructing these houses, where different aspects had to be put together to create a better environment, to make people happy, to feel better inside this environment. So it is not easy to construct a building like this, and also nowadays it's even more complicated if you consider old cities like the one we have in Europe, where there are historical buildings, hundreds of years building. You cannot modify very deeply, you cannot destroy. Probably in the United States they will destroy and build a new one. But there is a different situation there. So this kind of approach to create a smart building is not probably the direction to go, it's not feasible practically. Why this? Because we can have an alternative way to proceed toward the direction to make a building smart, that is the software. So using software solution to integrate the different subsystems inside such buildings and try to define strategies to control the different aspects that are the electricity, are the water, are the air conditioning, and the presence or not of the people, is the energy management. So a building is very complex. There are different things to be considered together. Probably to software we can define an environment, an overall infrastructure, a control system that is able to manage in a very smart way the behavior of the system itself. Okay? So this is the general idea, And this is a very simple and probably not even exhaustive way of subsystems that you can find in a building nowadays. Building, for sure you have power distribution, electricity, you have in all the rooms everywhere, corridors, you have air conditioning, you want to have some lighting control mechanism to decide if you need to keep all the lights on or not, depending on the lights outdoor, the presence or not of people in the room. If there are no people, why should I keep the lights on? Then you have energy monitoring and control. Maybe you have not this kind of problem here, but in Europe there is lots of attention towards the production of energy from alternative sources, that are the sun, the wind, trying to save as much as possible other kind of sources like oil, okay, or gas. And in that case, nowadays you try to transform the energy of the sun, for example, and then you want to store this energy in some batteries. Okay, so when the sun is not available, you can take the energy from the battery and use this energy for lighting, for example. Or maybe you can rent to the other apartment. Or you can pass to the public service for the lighting of a common square. So, also in that case, you need a control, very sophisticated control system, because this energy is flowing in different direction. So you have to optimize the way in which the energy should be divided and managed in such systems. Building management in general, renewable energy. So all these are some of the possible problems and some systems that you can find when you want to consider a modern way of organizing a building. And this picture, it's a mess, right? Yes, you don't understand anything, but it's there by intention, just to show how all these different subsystems are very complex to integrate each other. And the only way that you can follow is to use software. So you have the physical building on one side, you have the cyber environment on the other, you need to collect some information from this subsystem to bring here to analyze this data, to derive some knowledge from the rough data that comes from the physical system. Then you have to make probably some model to understand how things are moving, are progressing. And then maybe you have to wait some strategy, you are back to the physical system again, to control the system. So this is more or less the situation. And just to have an idea, we have a complex system where there is control system, alarms, the lighting, there is the air conditioning, security, energy management, and so on. Different subsystems nowadays that are somehow separated one from the other. We have these things more or less in our apartment, but they are completely independent one from the other. Well, instead, what we should like to do is try to integrate as much as possible, to have integration, one subsystem with the other, that allow to collect data, to make some kind of analysis, to make some automation, and understand how the data from this subsystem can be useful to control and manage and pilot the other one, and the way around. So these things can be done using, I think, software, or better, an integration of software with new technology, new device that are able easily to detect and monitor and control the system. This trend is clear. New buildings are built very often, maybe small cities again. You decide to define new cities. Why? Because there is also a global urbanization trend where the people keep on moving from the countryside in the city, and this is a forecast. Very clearly, the people living in the countryside will decrease, and those instead moving in the city will keep on increasing step by step. So these new requirements are extremely stringent, and there are some forecast what is going to happen in China, where in the next 10-20 years they will build new houses, new cities for overall size more or less equivalent to 10 times the size of the city of New York. Okay? And something similar also in India. You know that in these days there are some meetings in what are they? I don't remember, in France probably, I don't know, they are all the boss of the different countries in the world somehow are discussing about pollution, about the environment, trying to define new strategy to decrease the pollution in the world, maybe using less energy from oil, controlling the cars, providing new services so that you can have electric cars and so on. So they are trying to find new agreement, because it is evident that the environment is changing. We assist always more often to kind of a critical situation where it is not just raining, it's a thunderstorm, where the rivers they exit from their path and they cover the city. So very strange things are happening because somehow we are impacting too much on the environment. So controlling system that are able to understand what is happening and may help in defining new strategy in reducing the impact that we have on the environment itself. It is not just a case that I was mentioning these two country, because United States, China and India are the three countries in the world that produce more pollution. Probably this one is the third one, but if you divide by the number population, it is about 1 billion of people, it per single habitants in India is not so high, but overall it is country number three. And consider that in this country there are about 300 million people that they have not energy. They have not electrical energy in their apartment. So very soon they will enter the market. So they will be provided with electricity and new services. So the situation will become even worse, very, very rapidly. We are talking about years, not hundreds of years. Okay, so overall, the objective that we have is better living in our cities, in our environment. We want to have new advanced environment where you can work, live, enjoy. So there are all these input on one side, and on the other we have that the smart cities are very complex environment, not only in terms of the number of people that lives there, that can easily reach a million, tens of millions of people. New Delhi is about 18 million people, Cairo 19 million, Mexico 18 million. So we are talking about incredible number in one single city. Okay? And the situation will become even worse. So in a city you have different subsystem in the same way as in the single building. You have different subsystem that somehow are not so integrated each other. And also in that case, so we are moving from the single building to a set of buildings that is a city. Also in that case, we want to have mechanism to integrate the different subsystems together, because they are not independent one from the other. So I'm talking about smart houses, smart building, and we have energy management system, we have a smart energy production system that support our requirements, we have a smart transportation system, and so on. So the situation is really complicated. Different integration, and this is a picture I took last week in India, where this is normal, this is not something so unusual. You have an idea what is there. And there are 1 billion of people, and very soon they will also use cars, motorbike, in a always increasing way. So at the moment it is not so common to have a car, but you already see what is happening. And there are many other examples, many other cities where traffic control and where pollution in these days in Beijing, people are recommended to stay inside with the windows closed, because the level of pollution in the air is 15 times more than the maximum level that is allowable. Okay? So this is the situation. You really have this fog everywhere and you cannot see more than 50 meters. It is not just once per year, it's becoming very often the situation. Also in New Delhi last week it was like this. During the morning till 11, 11 and half, it was like this. I thought, strange, there is the fog in the morning. It was not fog from humidity, it was from fog from pollution. Okay? Okay. We have some examples of environment, or better, of the system, infrastructure, computing infrastructure, ICT infrastructure, that try to monitor what is happening in the environment. Like in this case, this is the city of, if I remember, some Beijing probably. Yes, they're making something. This is San Francisco, where they try to monitor the environment, pollution, energy requirements, amount of energy produced by solar panel against those produced from oil. So they try to monitor these things, but they are just examples. In general, what we can learn from this is that to make a city smart, we have three actions that should be done. One is to monitor. We have to be able to understand what is happening there. So we have to collect information, data, and this data can be collected through sensors that should be distributed, and you need a huge amount of these sensors. One possibility is to have a complex sensing device. I don't know here, but sometimes in Italy you find some blocks, there is a small house, maybe like this, 2 meters by two, where there are very complex and sophisticated device there that monitor the quality of the air, humidity, temperature and so on. For example, in my city there are, if I remember, 5 or 6 of these. They are very expensive, they put somewhere. This is a possibility. Another possibility is to supply the precision in detecting the real measure with a huge number of sensors, maybe not very expensive, not so sophisticated, but they are very cheap. So you can have many kind of sensors distributed in the environment. We are talking about thousands and thousands of these sensors that regularly collect some data and transfer to some complex system that is able to store this data and then to analyze and understand what is happening there. So in any case, this sensing, observation, and then communication is important. You have to know what is happening, otherwise there is no strategy, nothing to do. Then there is this second M, that means model. Model means that you should be able to understand what is happening for this huge amount of data. This huge amount of data generate the so-called problem big data. Okay, so we have a big data situation where there are so many sensors distributed in the environment and the amount of data that you are generating is so large that traditional technological approach to store this data and process are not good enough anymore. So there are different techniques that can be put in place to monitor that huge amount of data. But in any case, then you have to elaborate this data. And usually you need a model that is able to represents the evolution of the system according to the input data that you have. And with this model you try to understand, to forecast what is going to happen. Okay, so you may have a model for forecast, a model for pollution, a model for energy requirements in the next 24 days, hours, or 1 day, or 2 days, something like that. And when you have this simulation of what is going to happen, then you can try to manage your system, the third M, and you are back to the system itself, because here you understand what is the some parts of a smart city. So we may have some kind of device for energy management, smart meters, gas, or some device for parking, and so on. So there are different possibilities. They are already there. They are in place in some city. Probably they are a little bit more advanced than others. But this kind of sensing network, this is the name they are, sensor networks, are put in place. And there are already hundreds of these devices distributed. Usually, till now, they are separated. I am the owner of the sensor networks related with traffic management. I have a network with different cameras, okay, the city hall, for example, or some institute that is collecting data for research. Usually they are very different. They don't use similar standardized communication protocol. It's very difficult to integrate these data, collect and integrate. And there are even some examples, very sad examples, where these data are even transferred with a lot of delay. There was couple of years ago in Rome, so we are not talking about a strange city, Rome, and there was a very unusual situation with lots of snow. The city was completely covered with snow, and we are not used in driving with snow, ice, so people got confused, all the cars, there were lots of accidents, and the problem was there. They were able to detect the information from sensor distributed in the environment, forecast prevision. They were able to make the model and to understand that the thunderstorm was coming, the snow was there, but it was Friday night. And they were not able to communicate the information. So the information remained in the research center. They didn't send it to the city hall. So the city hall did not actuate any action to solve the problem. For you it's normal because you are used in this. But for Rome, snow is very, 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 very unusual. Maybe one every 10 years. Okay? So the disaster came. And we have other kind, other examples of strange situation like energy management plant, oil production system. These are some examples where I live, where somehow 4 years ago, 5 years ago, lots of rain, so disaster like this, and houses were destroyed, several people died. So. These are examples where you really need a sensing infrastructure that is able to understand what is happening, and probably then at least you can inform people, okay, leave, go away, something bad is going to happen. Instead they were in the house, just doing the usual life, and these things were happening because nobody was able to understand in advance that this kind of disaster was going to happen. And a situation like this are also in very advanced cities. In this case, we are in the underground, okay? All water here is swimming. And this was due to the Sandy hurricane in the United States. Disaster also in their case. But there are other examples, for when cameras that are airways sensors are able to understand, detect, control, and provide security solution, safety, like during the marathon Boston. There was some people killed there, but they were able to catch this guy because of controlling the different camera, going back to the data that were collected and stored somewhere, they were able to analyze and understand what was happening there. And I think that nowadays we can even add to this kind of sensing device, static device, we can also add your PDA, my PDA, they are some kind of sensing device. So the citizen himself, herself, is a sort of sensor, because we are able to collect some information from the physical sensor that we have on our system, and we can also provide inputs to the system through action that we usually do, for example, in social network. I'm talking about Facebook, I'm talking about Twitter and this like that, where we write some messages, something. There are some studies that try to analyze the huge amount of messages and data that are generated by this citizen sensor, and they understand, extract knowledge from this that is useful to understand how people are moving in the city, what is considered to be a safe area, a dangerous area, and things like that. Okay? So the citizen is in the loop because it is able, in any case, to provide information. The information that you give to the social network represents the real value for the social network itself. It is for free, and we all agree that we don't pay anything for Facebook and things like that. But we really pay through the data that we generate. For them are a great value because they are able to analyze this data and construct our profile. So they know better than us what we do, what we think, what we buy, what are our interests, and so on. So these kind of files for each of us are the profile of the different users. The more users you have, the higher is the value of the company itself. So this is why Facebook is, the value of Facebook is strictly related to the amount of users of Facebook, because each user has a value, okay? So when you use this system, of course, you have to be careful what you write, what you do, because these informations are there and can be used from different possible applications. Okay, citizen sensors, cars is another example. I just read yesterday that there are, I don't remember which kind of brand producing a new car, where these sensing devices are even more sophisticated. The car itself can detect lots of information automatically, autonomously, will send to the car producer. But the car can talk with the other car. If they are in opposite direction, they can exchange information about traffic conditions, things like that. So this is another example where sensors are distributed, they are on the move, and they collect information and provide inputs to sophisticated algorithms that can analyze this data and understand what is happening and that to add some action. Sorry?
Tesla.
Maybe, yes. This is not the only one. There are also other car producers that are working about that. There is a special research area that is vehicular networks, sensor vehicular networks, where they make special investigation, research activity on cars and the sensors, how these cars communicate, how the information is floating in a distributed environment, and so on. So our cars already collect a huge amount of data. Not always they directly transfer to somebody, but if you have a UMTS device in your car, they can runtime send information about how the car is moving, what you are doing, how you are driving, and many information like this. Okay, so I hope that at this point is clear that we have really a great amount of source of information. This information is usually rough data, difficult to understand, but we are talking about petabyte, exabyte of data. So you can imagine thousands and thousands of sensors that every few seconds they send some short string each, multiplied for these 10,000, 20,000 sensors. This is what we are talking about. The amount of information that you have to store and then process is really enormous, big data. And cloud computing can provide some interesting solutions to deal with such a huge amount of data. We already know this technology, directly or indirectly we are using it through Facebook, Gmail, Google Drive, Twitter, all these kind of services are based on cloud computing, because you are not aware of how the physical infrastructure is organized, where the data are stored, if there are or there are not backup mechanism, security solution. We have no idea about that. We always work at the very top level, at the application level, and all the details behind are completely hidden. So this is the value of the cloud computing approach that help you in automatically organize the infrastructure in terms of computing, storage device, and from what we are discussing, probably we can also include the sensing device. So you have the computing part, you have the storage part, and you have also the sensing. So you have the three basic elements of any computing system: CPU, disk, and I/O. So if we are able to create an environment where you can set up your infrastructure very easily, depending on the specific goal that you have. No? You want to deliver a service, then you can, you need a way to communicate with your system and say, okay, this is the kind of service I want to deliver. I need this amount of computing power, this amount of storage, this kind of sensing device, so distributed, able to provide this kind of information. Okay, help me in identifying this resource. According to cloud computing principles, you identify all these resources, you aggregate in a cloud, you create your infrastructure, and then you deploy your service, and the system starts. When you are done, you release everything, somebody else will rent this equipment and deliver a new service. Okay? So this is the scenario that I have in mind. With regards to the cloud, I will not go too much in these details, but probably you know, if you don't know, I tell you, we have these three layers, the infrastructure as a service, the platform as a service, the software as a service layer, that isolate different functionalities depending on the kind of impact that they have. So here we have the infrastructure level, where you talk about physical machine, virtual environment to emulate physical machine on top of a given hardware. Here instead you don't access this kind of details, but you are provided with some API that help you to develop your service on top of a given infrastructure. At this level, we already talk about software, services. So you are not aware about this kind of details, but you use Gmail, you use Facebook, that's it. And below, you have all these different aspects. So what we want to do, for example, is to move to work always at the infrastructure as a service level, including not only computing and storage, but also sensing and actuation device. Okay? At that point, the infrastructure is there. There is everything, all that you may imagine. You want to automatically set up this infrastructure, develop the basic services, and the top level service to provide services in complex environment such as smart city. Okay, OpenStack is an interesting middleware to create infrastructure according to cloud computing principle. It is an open source project. It was created. It is going on nowadays in Europe. And it involves a huge amount of companies that provide, deliver services on top of this infrastructure. And there are thousands and thousands of developers that contribute to evolve the different components of this software. It is nowadays very popular. And there are lots of applications on top of OpenStack to deliver even complex services. It is organized in a compute part, networking module, storage module, and the sensing module that we will add very soon. It is organized in different blocks that somehow isolate different functionalities, like for example Neutron, that is devoted to the networking aspects, Silometer, that instead is able to collect information from different devices, and so on. So in general, what I think is that if you get used to this kind of environment, probably it's a good investment from your side, because there are already many, many users, companies that look for experts in this kind of technology that want to develop solution on top of this on this technology. So it could be interesting to understand how it works, to install and execute some possible services. What follows is a short list of some examples of applications through projects, real projects, where we have been involved, and it covers different aspects, but the idea that is in common is the one we are talking about. It's complex environment, sensors to monitor, store and process this data, and then back to the system itself to implement some strategy. This Sigma project was over last end of October, so now, practically. It was a 2 year project, Italian-wide, okay? So several companies, research institute, university, about 20 partners there, very complex, articulated. And the goal of this project was to set up mechanism and a software solution to control different sensor networks belonging to independent and autonomous administrative entities, so to collect the information, to understand what is happening, and then to actuate some strategy. Examples, where we live in Sicily, there is a big volcano, is the biggest active volcano in Europe. Every couple of months there is some activity there, so some smoke, some vibration, some small earthquakes, so we are used with that. And one application of the project is the following. The volcano is monitored with about 100 sensors that are managed by the Geophysical National Institute. So there is the sensor network that collects lots of information, mainly related with the very small vibration of the mountain itself. So when these vibrations are detected, then there is an analysis of the intensity of this vibration that allow to understand the power of the possible eruption that is going to come. And then they analyze and detect the flow of ash that is coming from the volcano. Then they get information from the forecast institute to understand how the wind is moving, what is going to happen in the next 3, 4, 8 hours, because they want to predict the amount of ash that is coming from the volcano and how it will move and when it will fall down, because when it falls down it covers everything with this black ash. Everything, all the streets, house, roof, everything. It is very difficult to drive in that condition because the car slips very easily. So if you understand all of this, you can inform the population through other kind of sensors, their PDA, that they should not take that highway, they have to take this alternative path and so on. Okay? So this is a clear example of this feedback system. And this was experimented and provided in this project. This other project called Simone is a kind of subset of the previous one that instead strictly focus on electricity management. So here electricity is produced by solar panel, windmills, and you try to understand what you will need in the next 24-48 hours to understand if you have to buy electricity from the traditional providers or not, and if you have to buy, the amount that you have to buy, because you made a prediction and then you buy. If you use more than you were buying, the extra, you will be charged an incredible amount of money. So you want to be very, very precise in this. And in this case, the sensors are there to monitor the quality of the energy, to understand if there will be sun, there will be wind, and the intensity of the sun, the intensity of the wind. So this is this other example. Reservoir was probably the very first European project on cloud computing, and we were working here mainly at the infrastructure level, and as a university we were specifically focused on managing the computer center to deploy all the infrastructure, cloud-based infrastructure, and all the services that were developed in the project. And we start introducing the concept of federation, that in cloud means that the resources that you're going to use do not belong to a single provider, but to different providers at the same time. So you have agreement between different providers, so that when I say I need this amount of computation, I am not talking only with Amazon, like I can do today, but maybe talking with the Amazon, with the University of Kazan and some other providers, and they take some resources here, some there, some there. I can do because there are federation agreement between the different providers. This is the concept behind that. Vision Cloud instead moves a little bit up, and here we concentrate on the data management. So here the problem is how to deal with a huge amount of data, and is the application that should be moved nearby the data, or the data nearby the application? So these are the kind of questions that we try to address in this project. Well, instead in CloudWave, that is running, we just completed the second year of activity now in November. Here we are working at the application level. So here we talk about adaptation. So the adaptation of the application to the infrastructure, or if possible, or the infrastructure to the specific requirement of the application. Okay? In Beacon, we are focusing on federation. So here everything is related to federation, specifically federation between Open Nebula, that is a software and infrastructure provided by some Spanish partner, and OpenStack. So here the problem is how to federate these two different domains, how to let them dialogue and interchange information, so that you can take resources from Open Nebula and at the same time from OpenStack and use them in your cloud. It has been created runtime according to your specific requirements. Frontier City is another project where it is more application oriented. By definition, here you have to use OpenStack and Fireware, that is an infrastructure already available at European level, where several data centers are connected to each other, and you can use resources from all these data centers. They use this OpenStack environment, and in this case, the European Commission launched periodically some initiatives where they say, okay, I'm looking for ideas related to fleet management, to e-health, to energy management. So different companies applies, there is a selection process, and then they have to develop the solution on this infrastructure. Okay, we are in charge of the traffic module, in this traffic management module. Okay, so we are back to this picture, integration of physical world with the cyber world, and the previous project somehow touch these different aspects. Okay, so smart device that communicate each other and with the physical system, communication protocols such as COP and others such as AllJoin, that is a big group of industries, research center and whatever, that provide solution to have the objects to recognize each other and to talk, exchanging information. The limitation is that all the devices should be connected to the same network, okay? So you have to be on the same local area networks, otherwise it doesn't work. But with a solution I will show you, this problem has been solved. I will tell later on. So the situation where we are is the following. We have this physical system, we have some device that are able to detect the information, and this device has to sense the environment somehow, then actuate some action. So new sensing devices are quite sophisticated, and they have also computational power on board. So this kind of approach can even be developed further, so that you have the physical board on the physical system, and maybe the logic that is moved a little bit on the cyber world, that is where your cloud system is in production. And in that case, what is going to happen are different possibilities. So I can simply use this as a pass-through mechanism, because there is no real logic here, but everything stands inside. Then I can move further, and I can imagine something where there is a complex event processing that is done in my board, in the virtual part. Okay, so I am moving something, trying to move on the edge, okay? Or if the board is very sophisticated, I can even imagine that I can inject some specific software, some custom logic on the board itself, so that it detects the information, it makes some preliminary computation here, maybe actuate autonomously, or only sometime I will transfer the information to the upper layer. What I'm saying is that this board has nowadays complex and powerful enough that we can imagine to move some part of the computation of the logic to the edge of the system. You don't need to have all the data always transferred to the cyber part, but you can even implement some basic logic already at the board level. It depends if it is able to receive software, what kind of power is there, and so on. But there are different physical solutions that allow to do this. So, if this is true, then we are here, where there is the physical part, where you have the physical board that detect the information, then can actuate some action, the control logic that is somehow move at the cloud level, but in some case I can still have some computation here. It depends. So I need mechanism to interact with this board, to select them, to group in a cloud, sensor cloud. I need mechanism, if it is possible, to inject some code in the board itself, so the same board, the same hardware can be used to provide different kind of software services, or better, or services through software, right? But we already do this, because in your PDA you have hundreds of apps. So depending on the apps that you are executing, your system is behaving in a way or in a different way. So the same things you can imagine with these boards. The same board with some injected software that will operate in a way a little bit different from previous, where there was another kind of service that it was going to develop. So at this point we can introduce the concept of software defined everything, because it is up to the software to specialize and define the kind of services, application that we can deliver. And we can talk already about software-defined radio, software-defined networking. These are concepts already perfectly working, that are there, that are being used. There are companies, Akamai is dealing with about 20% of the overall internet traffic in the world, creating software-defined network on top of the physical internet, okay? So they try to distribute the information in different data centers, and they do this all through software. So we can also talk about software-defined storage, software-defined data center, software-defined building, and blah, blah, blah. So what I want to mention is that the software is acquiring an always increasing role in defining and controlling a complex system such as a smart city. The scenario that we will have at this point is something like this. We have different kind of sensors and actuators, and then you have contributors, maybe a single person with some sensors, and he says, okay, it's available, if you want, you can use. Maybe there are the processing part of the board, and piloting this device, collecting the data, and then processing with the computing part and the storage part already managed by OpenStack. I will pass you some pointers, so if you want to go more in detail, there are some papers on this. But we are imaging some sensing device where you have the control part, and there is the processing part, and inside the processing part we have this component that is called the lighting rod engine, okay, that is able to interact with this block to detect information, to make some computation, and then probably to actuate some action, at the same time to interact with the cyber world. So there is a communication channel for internal services, that is the one that you establish immediately as soon as you switch on the board, and then you can have different kind of services that are actuated with different communication channel, okay, where the information goes in this direction and in that direction. The way in which this is done is through reverse tunneling mechanism, because the scenario is the following: the cyber world is there. Then you buy a new Arduino device. You open, you put the electricity, you switch on. At that point is the Arduino device that has to communicate with the cyber world, saying, hello, here I am. Then the communication starts from the device itself. It goes to the cyber world, and this communication channel is created according to one mechanism. And then, depending on what I want to do with this device, then I create this yellow communication link where the information, service by service, is sent through. So this is the way in which it works. More detail we can see later. What I wanted to just show, this is the overall picture of the system, where you have the user here, and you have the Iotronic module here, and you have this conductor and database where the different boards are stored, with the information they have, the capability they have, and these are all the mechanisms, communication mechanism I was talking about. Okay, you have to read some papers to go more in details with these things, the different API. Another important thing that we can obtain with that kind of solution is this virtual networking. So we have a physical device distributed around, and using this VAMP mechanism, we can create a kind of short circuit between the different devices, such that we are not aware anymore of the physical network where the devices are connected. So we use this communication channel that goes through any kind of firewall, NAT mechanism, and so on, and we create the... No, I have not the figure here, but you can imagine something like this, where there is another board that makes the same kind of communication and enters inside this server. And then it's the server itself that creates the contact between this and this. So logically, these two devices are on the same network. Okay? At that point, for example, you can use all join. All join can be used because they are logically connected to the same local networks, so you can use all join. They can interact each other. An example could be a board like this here, another one in Messina, and if the board here detects temperature below 5 degrees, then a light will be switched on in Messina automatically, because they are logically on the same network and they can easily interact one with the other. Okay, evolution until like that. Second part, are you tired? I will be fast, okay? No more than another 10 minutes, just to complete the picture. Because this first part is mainly related to a general architecture. We are also talking about real implementation with OpenStack and things like that. But with regard to the single board, I was just imagining a board with these two components, the controlling part and the computing part, okay? Now let's try to see how we close the loop and we have all the different pieces in the right place. I start with this third industrial revolution. That is what? Is intended by someone, this maker movement. So maker are persons that are able to make things, to construct real things. And they are growing a lot. It's a kind of set of distributed groups all over the world where they sometimes meet together, they exchange experience, and they do these things. They construct, they prepare, they do some real object. I'm not specifically talking about ICT or software, hardware, any kind of objects, okay? They have some space where they meet, they have some fair where they show the results that they have produced. Some of them are interesting, some other are only some kind of curiosity. Probably you don't need a truck that is making this fire, but okay, they made these things and they were happy to show, okay? Okay, now, on the other side, we have the hackers world, people that are able to play with software. So they don't construct anything, but they are able to construct something in terms of software that is able to interact with the real objects. And Arduino is probably the technology that allow to bring together these two apparently separated community, the makers and the software developers, the hackers on the other side. Because through software you can interact with the external world, piloting different kind of action, understanding what is happening and controlling lights, bulbs, electrical engine and things like that. So this kind of technology is very cheap, but is also very powerful because easily, with a very simple code, allow people that are not engineers, they are not experts, they never studied computer engineering, software development, software engineering, no. But if you read this kind of code, probably anybody is able to understand. It just says, okay, some initialization or this kind of output will be the pin number 13, and then repeat what? Write high level on pin 13, wait for some time, write low, and repeat this several times. So very easily this is just flashing a light. So for the makers, this kind of technology is important because easily they can control and create new kind of objects, very sophisticated and very easily, very easily. So also at the elementary school they are adopting this technology to teach and train little kids to make simple kind of experiments. And of course they are not aware about operating system and all this theory, but very easily they can write these things and make something practical. Okay? And people get very satisfied when they see that the lights is flashing, when they see that the engine is moving or not. They immediately see the results of what they are doing. Okay, then, Arduino 1. Lenino is what? Is a project where we are trying to make even simple the integration between the universe of the hackers and the universe of the makers. And this is done through Linino that provides a set of components like open hardware, open software, embedded development environment, interaction with the cloud, lots of people working there. So Linino represents a set of elements that can be easily integrated together following this kind of philosophy. There is the module that provides the computation and also the Wi-Fi connection, and this module may interact with different kind of microcontroller units produced, for example, by Atmel or Freescale or ST Microelectronics. So we are separating the microcontrolling part and the computing part on the other side, and you can keep the same logic here and you can change the technology with regards to the microcontrolling unit on the other side without big problems. And at the same time, that component is able to provide wireless access. So one of these boards is also an access point once you switch it on. And they can communicate also through wireless, the different device, one with the other. So the new device from Arduino, they have this logic. You have the microcontroller unit, you have the microprocessor, there is a Wi-Fi connection, all in one single board. So there is one part that is specifically focused on interacting with the external world, with the I/O input-output, with the digital conversion, analogic, digital, and the way around, and the other part where there is OpenWRT, that is Linux operating system, and you can execute your code and pilot and automatically dialogue with the controlling part. Linino I/O is this kind of evolution where the communication between the microprocessing part, the microcontrolling part, is even further extended. In the sense that the different I/O device that may use different kind of protocol, analog, digital converter, GPIO, PWM, I2C, different way of receiving signal or actuating some action, are managed according to Linux file. So these devices are seen as Linux files that are logically connected inside your processing part. So through file mechanism you can easily communicate with these objects that represent the external world. Okay? So Linino I/O provides all these mechanisms, making even simpler the interaction with the external world. Okay? And these are some example where, for example, here we say that, okay, modify the motor speed, there is some speed connected, and on this file, okay, it says bring this value. Or, for example, read from cut, no? Read through this file, the value that is connected there is another port, and so on. So very easy from this point of view. The stack that is behind there, these are different products from Arduino. This is the UN device, this is Arduino One, is the same, but the size is exactly half of this. You have this possibility to extend the functionality of this board just adding shields, one on top of the other. So you can take these things and put a shield here that is automatically connected and provide some extension, like for example GPS functionality, like for example UMTS connectivity. Okay, so you already have Ethernet connection, you have Wi-Fi, but if you want to have UMTS, you buy a UMTS board and you plug on top of it, automatically you extend the functionality of the board, so they can grow in this way. So, at the first layer, we have the MCU-based device. Then you have the module that provides the processing unit and the Wi-Fi connection. On top of this you have Linino with the OpenWRT, is the Linux release that is being executed on these components. Then you have Linino IO that helps you to virtualize the different input-output port like a file. Then you have IDEino that is the IDE. The developing environment for the programmer that allow you in a graphical way to combine all these things, and then on top of this you have the different kind of applications that belongs to many many different possible areas. Okay, so the idea that we had of software defined everything now can become a special application in terms of cities, so we can talk about software-defined city, where we extend this approach, and there are many kind of controllers, like the one we are talking about. There is the software on the other side, that is CyberWorld, OpenStack, and so on. And somehow we have all the elements that represent our picture, and we are back to this figure where all the different parts now are filled with real things. Feedback system, we already talked about that. These are the technology that we are using at the moment, OpenStack, then we have extension through BAMP, Arduino Uno. We are also interacting with the Raspberry Pi, is a different producer of components, but of course for us it's easier to dialogue with Arduino because we work together, we have this company there, so it's very simple to interact with them, and we do every day, all the students and ourselves doing that. Example where we are using this technology, like SmartMe. As I mentioned at the beginning, this was a crowdfunding initiative, so we asked for some money through the internet because we had this idea to create an infrastructure in the city that can be used for different services. But we didn't want to impose this project. We didn't want to the people consider this project as an initiative from the university. No, it's something that should start from the bottom. So we wanted to create this community of people that had somehow interest in this kind of infrastructure. This is why we talk with Eppela, is one possible engine, crowdfunding engine available on the internet. We explained what we wanted to do. We launched these initiatives asking for 15,000 euro. And after a couple of months, we collected about 34,000 euros from different supporters. They are single citizens, students, researchers, also from abroad, some companies, some of them also, this one is from United States, this one is from Spain, and associations like City Hall, company dealing with the public transportation system, and so on. So we somehow created a first group of about 80 people interested in this kind of ideas that supported in different way, from few euros to even more. The American company put about 7,000 euro or more, so it depends. And we started this project. The project is to create the environment, different sensing device distributed all around, data collected, stored in the cloud, processed in the cloud, and then maybe results back to the citizenship, to the citizen, and so on. Applications are related to possible areas. Here there are some of them. I will tell you what is already available and what we are going to work in the next weeks, next months. Okay, this is clear, blah, blah, blah. We are back to this picture. Okay. So, This is the monitoring device that we are distributing in the city. Inside you cannot see, but there is an Arduino UN board with a shield that is called Tinkerkit. It's a sort of extension where you have lots of pin where you can connect like temperature, humidity, noise, lighting, and many others. So these are the ones that we provide. So by default there will be about 50 of these devices distributed in the city with 4 or 5 different kind of sensing components there that starts collecting this data. These data are sent to Fireware, that is the OpenStack based infrastructure at the European level. They are stored somewhere in the cloud and you can get the data. The idea is that everything is open, so open hardware, Arduino, open software, OpenStack is open, and also the data are open. So we collect this data, we store somewhere, you can access, you can download this data and use, analyze and develop a new service. So the idea is to stimulate the interest of other groups in assessing this data and creating new services that could be of interest for the city. Other example is this one, where there is the Arduino UN. There is this board that provides GPS and GSM connectivity. And this is the Tinkerkit. So these things then is organized in a box and is put on the buses. While the bus moves every 15 seconds, he collects information about position, speed, acceleration, temperature, pollution, noise, things like that, and send the information again to OpenStack to the cyber world where the things are stored. The company itself will use only some of these informations related on the position, speed and so on, because they want to understand the delay that customer has to wait in the bus station till the bus comes. Okay? So they know exactly where the bus are and they can predict the time to reach each bus stop. At the same time they can understand the congestion level in the street depending on the speed of the bus itself. So there are some algorithms that are able to understand the crowd in the street itself. But at the same time they collect other kind of information such as humidity, temperature and so on. They are not directly interested, but they contribute to the community and they put this information always in an open format everybody can use. So you can have, for example, surface on the map of the city that tell you where is where are the areas where that are more noisy or the area where that are more polluted and things like that. This application instead try to include citizens as sensors. We already talked about citizen sensors. The idea is to develop a service to identify promptly the potholes in the streets. So you use your PDA, there is an app that you can install, and this app detects the sudden variation of acceleration along the Z axis. So while you are driving, if you enter a pothole, there is this sudden variation and you report. If there are several reports from the same position, latitude and longitude, then we say here there is a pothole. And the entity is a function of the amount, the size, the entity of the variation of the acceleration. In a couple of days we mark the different holes in the streets with a group of 40 students that went around doing their usual life, but with this application running. Okay? So it's a simple example of crowd sourcing, where you have input from the crowd. Okay? This is another example where we are using some of this technology in a different environment. This is a museum dedicated to Guttuso is a famous painter in Italy, painter and also some sculptures are there. So they wanted to monitor the temperature and the humidity inside the museum, and we are using exactly the same solution in Smart MEI, the one I showed you, the first one at the beginning. And they also wanted to have an alternative way of visiting this museum. So using your PDA, you will have a personalized path inside the museum, so you go in room by room, not essentially in a sequential way. It depends on who I am, the interest I have, the time I have, so the path will be constructed real time, and the informations of each paintings and sculpture will be filtered and organized for myself. So if we are both looking at the same picture, probably we will receive different informations. If I am a kid, I have something in the form of cartoon or something like that. If I am an expert in history, maybe I will have lots of informations about history. Okay, so it's an example of Internet of Things and different technology used there. If you come to Sicily, you will visit the museum and you will have an idea. Other applications we are working on that are smart lighting. The City Hall gave access to the lighting in the main square of the city to implement some solution that allow to dim, switch on, switch off the different lights, depending, for example, on the lights in outdoor. People, if they are there or not, maybe I can switch some of these lights. If there is nobody there, I can switch and save some energy, so we can make some experiment there. Smart parking is another application. We are using some special kind of sensors so we can understand if in a parking spot there is a car or not. The information is transferred on the web, on the internet. When I want to park, I have an app and I say I would like to park, and the system will inform me about what are the parking places nearby where I am. I select the one I am more interested in, probably the one where there are more free spaces, and it will drive me. When I park, it will start counting the time, and then when I go away, I understand I'm leaving, and it will charge me for the amount of time I was there. Other applications are related with the e-health and precision agriculture to monitor the quality of the soil, the humidity, and parameters like that to improve the crop growing. Okay, I provided also some reference there, so you can go a little bit more in detail if you are interested. Possible project proposals of the development of this environment or developing on new services, applications. There is still lots to do. We are at the very beginning, so there are lots of things that can be done. And I really think that we are at the beginning. So the first step probably is there, but much more steps should be done, maybe also together if you are interested. So thank you very much. I think I went even much over the time I had. If you have questions, I will try to answer. Thank you.